Assalamu alaikum. Welcome to the Munir Muhammad Show. I'm Mandeen T. Muhammad. Welcome you to another edition of the Munir Muhammad Show, presented by Crow Media, a production with you in mind. This is a live show. We are streaming live. It's interactive. The number to call in is 773-434-6625, 773-434-6625. If you're checking us out via Facebook, please like and share the broadcast. Also, you can check us out via YouTube, Crow TV's YouTube page. Please like and subscribe so you get notified every time that we go live. And in reference to both YouTube and Facebook, like Mom used to say, please share because sharing is caring. So just in case someone wants to, they may not have the opportunity to view it right now, they can check it out later on, or you may want to go and review it because it's going to be a lot of information given out on this particular show. I want to remind our viewing audience that we're starting our free film showing once again. The free film showing will be taking place this Saturday, acknowledging or in remembrance of the birth anniversary of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, which is actually October the 7th, but the film showing will be October the 8th. Prior to the film showing, as you already know, Crow has expanded. Not only we just, that's why we're doing Crow Media. Not only we're just doing television, but we have expanded into internet radio right now as well. So we're on 24/7. You can always hear the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, Minister Farrakhan, Malcolm X, all of the students associated with the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. But now every Wednesday at 2 p.m. we are streaming live. And this Saturday from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. Sister Kim Muhammad will be doing a special dedication for Brother Munir Muhammad. And so it'd be a live call-in show on Crow Radio. And give us a call during that time. You can get the Soundgarden app and search Crow Radio, and you can listen to it anytime. And if you just want to check us out, because we do stream live on those outlets as well, you can also check it out on Crow Radio's Facebook page and also on YouTube. So again, that free film showing is this Saturday at 2 p.m. And we're looking for, and it's free. So, and the film will be part one of the Violet Drive series. It's Buzz Anderson interviewing the Honorable Elijah Muhammad in Phoenix, Arizona. So definitely you want to check that out. So without further ado, our first guest today is a longtime friend of the organization, former alderman, currently a judge, just an all-around good person, our dear sister, Judge Fredrina Lau. How are you, ma'am?
I'm doing fine, and thank you for that wonderful introduction.
I think that's my first time actually saying your first name. I'm usually used to saying Judge Lau or Alderman Lau.
Well, you got it right.
Yes, ma'am.
That's the main thing.
How you been, ma'am?
Doing good. We survived the pandemic, you know, and that threw everybody off their mark, and had to go home and work remotely and hold court in my dining room the last 2 years. So that, of course, was different. Hmm. And now we're moving back into the building, but we're doing it slowly because people still are walking around with communicable, airborne kind of diseases, and they refuse to wear masks. So, but I'm doing good.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, I'm glad to be here.
I just have to ask you, do you prefer working from home, or do you miss the hustle and bustle of the downtown area?
At first, I missed downtown. Then I said, oh, this is okay. I don't have to fight traffic, and it's not in the winter. I don't have to put on all those clothes. But I've worked harder since I've been home than I do when I'm downtown, because when you're in the court building, you hear a case, people come in front of you, you hear the case, you get your law clerk here, and there's a court clerk, and then you just hand her the paper, and she takes the paper and processes it and puts it in. Well, once we went remote, we didn't have that court clerk there.
So you became a court clerk.
So my law clerk became the court clerk, and I became the law clerk.
Yes, ma'am.
So we, you know, have to get the orders to me and read them and keep them in. I had to learn all about Zoom and Google Docs and other things, how to store things on file systems on this machine and find out where I get them, I read them, I don't know where I put them.
But yes, ma'am.
So it was
aside from having to deal with the court proceedings, you got to do all this technical stuff and extra paperwork and
So
just ongoing learning experience, huh?
it definitely was a learning experience. I had young people all around me on standby so I could call them and ask them how to get something done. But it's good. The technology changes. We older people need to keep up with technology. And even when we go back into the building full time, the Justice Anne Burke, who's retiring this year, had already said that she wanted Zoom to remain some part of what we do because it allows people to come to court and not have to come downtown.
Yes, ma'am.
You don't, you know, if you have a status hearing, it may take 10 minutes. You have to come downtown. Usually, if it's a senior, they may have to get someone to drive them. You got to pay to park for 10 minutes. And so
Yes,
you
ma'am.
could do that from home. So we're now putting computers and monitors in the courtroom so that I can be in the courtroom, the lawyers can be in the courtroom, and Mrs. Jones can come in from home.
Yes,
So
ma'am.
we're trying to move into
I
the
got you.
next century.
Yes, ma'am. And it seems like it's going to happen whether we like it or not.
Yeah.
I want to take you back before we talk about your current position to when you were actually an older person. And so, how many years did you serve as alderman of the Sixth Ward? The Great Sixth Ward, I should
The
say.
Great Sixth Ward, 13 years.
13
Yeah,
years. And
yeah.
so what, I've been interviewing a lot of would be aldermen that's been coming on the show of late, and with so many of the current aldermen stepping down or retiring for whatever reason, it's even when they don't, people come out the woodworks to run against the alderperson. But now it's like it's at least a good 15 to 20 in each ward. So, but what inspired you during that time to even run for that office?
John Steele was the alderman before me, and he resigned to spend more time with his family. And he called me one day and said, "I think you'd be good. You live in the community. You've got a law degree. You know what I've done, and you can read the law. You can read the statute. You can, and I think you'll be good." So after talking to my family, I said, "Okay." And then once I got the job, when it came time to run again, I felt that I needed to run because I had things that we were working on. We were working on children's programs. We did a lot of programming. And plus, you always have this feeling, and it's true, you can never get finished. And so you're always trying to finish. You got this, and you want to finish this, but it's a job that you'll never finish
Yes, ma'am.
because the needs will always change, and there'll always be a need in our community.
Now, did he step down before? I mean, did he end his term, or did he step down before his term
Oh no,
ended?
he stepped down like during his term, and I think maybe there were about 18 months left when he resigned.
And so, were you appointed? He was
I was
appointed. Okay.
appointed, and then I filled the unexpired portion of his term, and then I ran at the next election.
Okay, and you got it from there. Okay, all right, because I couldn't remember, so yeah, that's some history. And so if
It
the
was a while.
almost like the at that time the godfather or the person with the most renown in that particular area give you this blessing, so that's a pretty good thing.
Well, we had a unique ward at that time, but again, we keep talking about at that time because everything changes. Every day there are changes. Every day there are new people moving into the ward, which is why in that position and in any public service position, the need continues and situations change. So the ward boundaries have changed this time. What used to be the sixth ward is a little different now. But that's what life, the only thing constant in life is change.
Change. And things are going to change with Chicago politics, so
Yes.
you gotta play the game and learn and know the rules. And
And yeah, and I think that one of the differences that I see now than when I first started as the alderman was there's the need has increased, but the resources have decreased. And so you have less of an ability to effect positive change for your community. And so it makes it harder. And I think that's what you see one of the reasons you see a lot of people leaving, because it's just getting harder and harder and harder, and with no change in sight, you know, in terms of that part.
So. I know Alderman Beavers used to say a lot of times that when you first get in office, you know, you can't even get a garbage can or a stop sign, you know, but once you, you know, longevity and seniority has its place. But as you just pointed out, it seems like now, even if you've been there, you know, 15, 20 years, it's just difficult to get things, to make things happen now. And it's like, and then the people, they don't care. They just know what they requested hasn't been taken care of, so everybody can get it. You know, mm-hmm. somebody's going to feel their wrath. And so I can understand, you know, why the people are starting to jump ship.
Yeah, you don't have the power of the purse. That rests with the mayor, mm-hmm. because in this case, she gets a budget and she can allocate that budget as she likes. The aldermen get a menu, and recently they got a grant that they were able to give out to their ward. But you don't control streets and sand, so you can't call somebody up and say, hey, get out here, Ms. Jones, stuff needs to be fixed like yesterday. Because those people report to the mayor. Mm. And people don't understand that your constituent, they don't care who they report to, they just want it done.
Right.
So if the tree doesn't get trimmed, you get blamed. If there's, you know, potholes that don't get filled, you get blamed. And it just becomes harder and harder to provide services and then deal with the monumental problems that we have in our communities.
Yes, ma'am.
So I understand why some of them are leaving.
Do you miss being in that position as an older person?
I miss relationships with the people that I worked with. Mm-hmm. Some of those are older people, some of them weren't, but the people in the community, the various community associations. But I don't miss being yelled at. I don't miss people blaming me about the snow. I don't miss people, you know, blaming me about their streets. I don't miss being responsible and being blamed for everything that was out of my control in many instances.
And you certainly don't miss being interrupted while you grocery shopping or having dinner somewhere when the constituents run up on you.
I was, when my mother was alive, we were at a Mother's Day brunch, and a constituent walked up to us while we were in line getting a plate for my mom and my niece. She was about 8 then. Mm. And she was like, nice little lady, you know, I know this is not a good time, but could you? And my niece just blurted out, you are so rude. And I was like, you can't say that to people, but yeah, you are kind of rude. Do you mind talking to me Monday? No, I don't miss that at all.
Yeah, from the mouth of babes, huh?
Yeah.
So you went on to become a judge. Mm-hmm. And how long have you been a judge now?
I came in December 2011. That's when I came on the bench, and everybody starts in traffic, so I did traffic, and then I went to elder law, mm-hmm. and currently I'm assigned in the Chancery Division, hearing mortgage foreclosures, slash elder law and miscellaneous remedies, so I still have an elder law call, and in addition to my regular mortgage call.
Yes, ma'am. Are there anything that you experienced or lessons that you've taken from the alderman's office into being a judge?
That was basically the whole elder law program.
Okay.
I had so many seniors that I was interacting with in the community, because we had some seniors that bought a house years and years and years ago, and they aged into the house. Mm-hmm. In some families and some communities, people buy starter homes. In our communities, they don't buy starter homes and then move. They bought this house, they put their blood, sweat, and tears in it, and I had seniors basically saying, they're gonna take me in the box out of here. So we had a lot of seniors that had aged in place, and I was able to translate what I learned dealing with them and the unique kind of problems they were having into the elder law division. And I still do that with regular mortgages that are coming in, and the elder law cases that come in through the mortgages foreclosure section. So
And so I'm pretty sure you have it's a lot of people that come in and just really don't know what's going on, and you know, need help. So is that part of the elder law program, to make sure that somebody's there to assist those seniors?
Yes and no. They have to get referred to me. Usually they will be assigned to a court, and to the extent then that they have an issue that judge feels they need additional time, special attention, then they send them to me. In the foreclosure division, of course, those cases, I have them, they're coming directly into me, so I can just put them over into elder law. And I do the same thing in elder law as I do in the regular mortgage foreclosure call. I just do it a little slower. I have a special court that hears elder law cases, and we have less people because the seniors don't want to be in the room when there are 50 people in there because they're afraid that, they're going to sound stupid when they're asked a question. And so we need to have a smaller venue when we're in the building in person, and I have an elder law matter. I come off the bench and sit at the table with them because I don't want them having to stand up in front of the bench.
Yes, ma'am. And
We
that sounds
also,
rare within itself for a judge to come
well,
down, yeah.
but the judge is a title.
Yes, ma'am.
That's not who I am.
Yes,
That's
ma'am.
just the title. That's just the honorific they give you because of the job. And I knew if my mom came down, I wouldn't want her standing up there for 20, maybe 30, 40 minutes. She may not be able to do it.
Yes, ma'am.
So I just, I try to accommodate them to the best I can in terms of physical accommodations. And then we have a relaxed environment to have conversations with them when they come down. And bring your daughter. Who you living with, bring her down too. So, because I know that when you leave, you're going to ask what I said. So let her come on up here so she can hear. Because we live in extended multi-generational homes in our community
Yes,
and other
ma'am.
communities too. So.
Understood. We got a couple of callers. You mind taking a call or two?
Absolutely.
Old time, say. Caller, you're on the air.
Assalamu alaikum.
Walaikum salam, ma'am.
And good evening to your guests and welcome back to the show.
Thank
My
you.
question is, what is the duty of the alderman? Because it seems as though whatever we request to be done, they are unable to do it most of the time. And my next question is, I am senior, and once before I was called for jury duty, I live in South Holland, Illinois. And when I'm called for jury duty, it's either in Maywood now or next Monday, I am to report to Bridgeview, Illinois. Is there any way that I can change and they give me a location near me or downtown instead of having me to drive all the way over to another suburb? Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. Your first question. The aldermanic position is a legislative position, technically. Under the statute, the book says they're legislator. So they are supposed to be writing laws. They're supposed to be o conducting oversight over the budget, over the departments, even though they report directly to the mayor. Those are the kind of things that technically the job title says. Years ago, they had a lot more control over what happened in their ward, but with every successive mayor, there's been some pullback of control. Meaning, years ago, you had a ward superintendent and you dealt with your ward superintendent, and he had crews that worked for him. And then a couple of past mayors began pulling some of those people back into the mayoral budget and began having them report. So the ability of the alderman to do provide direct services is diminished. And what they do now and what they did when I was there 13 years ago is we could not directly make someone come and do something, but we could worry them. We could call their bosses, we can call and stay on their case, and we could constantly worry them until they got out there and did our constituents' job. But they are responsible to the community. Their job is really legislative. It morphed into, and this was way before me, it turned into like a housekeeping job. You were in charge of the ward, but that's really not the job of the alderman. Second question regarding jury duty. the we have a jury commissioner, and you can contact them. And I know at some age, and I don't know what that age is, but at some age you can even get out of jury duty, which we do not recommend unless it's a hardship. But in terms of they have six branches, six divisions here in Cook County, one going as far as Rolling Meadows, Bridgeview, Markham, Maywood, and of course the Daly Center, and I know I forgot one, maybe Skokie. Mm. So they send people based on need, and it's computer generated, but call them and talk to them about that, and you may be able to get them to somehow designate you for a certain community. I don't know if they can do that, though, because it should be random. The other thing, since we're talking about jury duty, and this certainly does not apply to you because you're going, and that's what you're complaining about. When they call you, you have to drive there. Our number one complaint that we have as judges that is people don't show up. Mm-hmm. We need people to come to jury duty. When you have a jury either in civil court or in criminal court, people will come in, and as soon as you get to them in the selection process, they say, oh, I'm sorry, I can't come. I've got five kids at home, and my mom's, she's got really serious injuries, and I need to be there. Sometimes it's true. Every time it's not. And what we've seen that if we let somebody off that's early in the selection process, for whatever reason, then 12 more people are going to come up with that reason. We need you to be in the jury pool. We need you to be there because the person that's coming either to civil court trying to get a money judgment for an injury that they suffered, or the person is trying to get a fair trial at 26 in California, they want to look out and see somebody that looks like them on the jury. And if you're in the criminal division, definitely we need you to be there on that jury because you may be the vote that saves some young person's life.
Because it's hard to complain about, the verdict when you have the opportunity to participate and you find a reason not to, so.
Yeah, so we want them to come to court. I want people to come to court, and I don't have juries anymore. I want them to come because if I get 20 new cases in an afternoon, and that's the first time people are to come to court for foreclosure. They've got to serve the summons. They gave it to you. Says, come to court on this day. Of those 20, three may show up.
Yes, ma'am. Mm.
17 people don't show up. Some of them for reasons that maybe they've already decided they couldn't save it. Some people because they don't know what to do. But if they'd come to court, I would have told them what they needed to do, where to go for a resource, go to talk to a housing counselor, and they can go through the steps with you if you're trying to save your house. Even talk to you and go over your documents with you and tell you whether you're eligible for various programs. But they have to come to court, and we won't do that.
Are there any outside of the courtroom dealing with the seniors that programs or events that you're involved in? Do you go to speak to groups or organizations or things?
I was at Park Manor Neighbors on Monday at 6 o'clock for their community meeting. So we go to community associations, and it's not just me. The court has a speakers bureau, and the Illinois Judicial Council, the African American Bar Association for Judges, primarily African American. We do have some non-black members. We have a speakers bureau, and we have program judges in the court, in the schools. We go to schools, we go to churches. In fact, on the 16th, we're going to worship in a church in the community. Mm. And so we're trying to reach out because we want people to be able to actually say that they know a judge, because maybe then they won't be so afraid to come to court.
Yeah.
Not that you know us and we're going to hook your case up, because we don't do that. But
just let them know that early.
Yeah, well, you wouldn't want a judge that did that for you. Mm-hmm. Because then you had to worry, if you're on the other side, what am I doing for the other person? So no, you don't want judges with the hookup.
Yeah.
You want judges to be fair.
You want them to be fair, but there's nothing like coming in the courtroom and seeing somebody that looks like you, though.
It is, and which is also the reason that they want them on juries. Mm-hmm. It feels, you get a sense of comfort when you know that at least somebody over there knows the lingo. They know the lingo. They have maybe they've had the similar experiences, and maybe they can understand what you're saying when you're talking and what position you're coming from and the hardship that you've had.
Yeah, exactly, exactly. Another thing with, you know, and the reason why, one of the reasons why you're here, to make sure we keep people on that look like you and competent people that look like you. You have an election that's coming up in November, and it's one of those elections where everyone needs to be retained.
The we've got a big election in November for everybody.
Yes, ma'am.
In this country. It's a big election, and we have judges who won the primary in June, and they're going to be on the ballot. And then at the very end of the ballot, we have 60 names of judges who need to be retained. The law requires that every judge who is elected stand for election during their term. So if you are a circuit court judge, you have to run to be retained every 6 years. If you're an appellate court judge, you have to run every 10 years. If you're a Supreme Court judge, you have to run every 10 years. So this class has Justice Tice, who is from the Supreme Court. We've got four or five, I brought the list, because I know I can't remember it all.
Yes, ma'am.
Judges who are running from the appellate court, including Leroy Martin. And then we've got the remainder, our full circuit judges like myself. And our class begins with the Honorable Chief Judge,
Timothy Evans.
Yeah. And so we've got 50-some people who are running from all over the county. They're sitting in every courtroom. And the one thing that I can say about every one of them is that these are seasoned judges, because you had to be on there at least 6 years to be on that list. It's a daunting task, not for the those that run, but it is for us who run anyway, but for the citizen, because I go into the back and I'm looking on the ballot and I see the last page and I see 60 names. I don't know any of these people.
Yeah.
But we are asking that people definitely go to the back, and we're asking that people who feel that it might be overwhelming check other sources before you go. The Cook County Bar Association, the oldest association of African American lawyers, quote, and judges, oldest one in the nation, they rate judges and have been doing so for years. So they have a list of those people that they found recommended or not recommended. Mm-hmm. The other bar associations do also. So we encourage people to go on the internet and check the recommendations. Ask people. You know somebody who's a lawyer? Ask them what judges they think are good. Our campaign is to vote for everyone.
Yes, ma'am.
It says vote yes, but I get some blowback on that. You know, so I am saying, don't take my word, even though I'd like for you to do that. But check it out. I've been evaluated by all the bars, as have all of the other judges that are running. And so I'm very happy to say that everyone has found me qualified and well qualified. The question this time was, are they qualified to remain on the bench? And most of the bars, they agreed that the answer was yes or no. So they just said yes, 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 yes. And then an organization, the Chicago Council of Lawyers, did a little script about why they voted for these people, why they rated these people, mm-hmm. and then they came out with qualified, well qualified, or highly qualified.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, most of the judges have been rated qualified and say
yes,
vote yes.
But why do you think it's so little fanfare when it comes to the judges? And I mean, they got the judges all the way in the back of the list. I didn't realize it was that many running. I knew it was a few that I'm familiar with that was running for retention. But then you mentioned at least 60 people that's running, and you know, a lot of them you don't even, you, like I said, you don't know.
Right.
You try to go with the people. I mean, I may be familiar. I have an advantage from being involved with the show over the years, being familiar with different people. But for the average Joe or Joanne citizen, they don't know who these people are. They, you know, a lot of times we joke about it, but they just see a name they may, you know, be able to associate with.
And that happens in real life. We have anecdotes. We can show you statistics that show that people are voting for people with certain names. We are at the back because we're not quote-unquote politicians anymore. We can't.
But they got you doing politician's work.
Yeah, well, you know, yeah.
Yeah.
This is a ballot that starts off with the governor, then the lieutenant governor, then the attorney general, all the way down, and then your county officers are on the ballot, and then the judges come at the back. I used to say when I was in office and we'd have retention, I'd tell people, start at the back so you don't get tired, because I know you're going to go through all the way and vote for the governor, because that's so important nowadays. But I'm asking the people who still have time to get their ballot and voted at home.
Yes, ma'am.
You can contact one of the bar associations, or multiple, or you can go and see what the papers are saying about people. You can call your friends who are lawyers, and you can sit up and do it at your kitchen table, as opposed to having to stand up in that polling place and click or put the X for 60 people, because I know people aren't going to do that.
No.
And I know we're running out of time, but we only have like 15 blacks out of that 60. You'll see us more because we come on shows like yours, but we are still a small minority in the court system.
Yeah, and that's unfortunate, but we're trying to change that. We're moving towards it now, but we got a caller too, so let's see what they have to say. Caller, you on the air?
Assalamu alaikum, brother.
Wa alaikum salam, ma'am.
And greetings to Judge Lyle.
Yes.
I have two questions. I know the housing courts are still doing Zoom court cases. For your foreclosure cases, are those in person? And I know that you were saying about the seniors. Are there any programs that people can look online that possibly are going through it and not necessarily in the foreclosure? And, and my last question is, how do you all handle your safety aspect? You all do a lot of unfavorable things and make unfavorable decisions, and some people don't like it. How is the safety set up, and do you feel safe in your job? Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. Very good questions. I'll start with the last one first. We have a real problem with safety. I live in the community, and ironically, and I probably shouldn't say it, but I feel because I live in the community that some of the people that get mad with me I'm not threatened by them, because I say by the time they come to my community and see Pookie on the corner, they're not going to get out their car, you know. But that's making very light of it. We have, at every educational conference that we go to, there's a seminar on safety. They've asked us to take our names out of the public records. I had a mad litigant go online and pull a copy of my deed and come to court and say things about, you know, my...
Wow.
So we've had... I mentioned to you what Judge Bill Hooks. Bill Hooks had some of the white supremacists come to his home and had to have a sheriff place a car in front of his house. And I was saying that they picked the wrong one that day, because Bill is a former Marine. He probably had a gun in every corner of his house. But fortunately, it didn't get to that point.
Yeah.
So we are very concerned about safety. And do I feel safe? Yes and no. So I'm much more aware of the safety issues, because things are happening to other judges, not necessarily here in Chicago, but in this country. And I know that crazy people have cars.
Yes, ma'am.
So, you know.
Yes, ma'am.
And that's one question. In terms of the programs for seniors, you can go on the Illinois Housing Development Authority and the Cook County Housing Authority, and whatever programs they have, they will have them listed online, and some of them are for seniors, but most of them in terms of foreclosures are not really directed towards seniors, because people of all ages are losing their homes. Mm-hmm. And so the assistance is not age restricted. And then the first question, going backwards, was, are we still on Zoom? And the answer is yes, we are. We are at like 50% status now. And even when I go into the building for 50% of the time, I'm doing Zoom from my chambers.
Okay.
Because I have a high volume courtroom. One day I had as many as 82 cases between the morning and the afternoon, and each one could have one person or multiple people, and we don't want to put 150 people in a courtroom yet. Because we are still concerned about viruses and epidemics. So we are working from home, and some of the divisions are back in. The ones that have, you know, like maybe five people that might come into the courtroom during at a time, they're in person.
Gotcha. Do we have another call? Yes. Caller, you on the air?
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam.
Good evening to your distinguished guest, the Honorable Fredrin Alau.
Good evening.
Good to see you again. Good to see you again, Sister Fredrina.
Thank you.
When I think about judges, you know, I think all the way from sub-circuits to circuit to county to state to federal, all the way up to the Supreme Court. And it appears to me that the Supreme Court is a little, and I know this is way up there, but it seems to me that they're having some trouble with the issue of just identity of being impartial. They seem to be leaning, just because they have the advantage, the conservative advantage, they seem to be actually voting along that line instead of being impartial. What does impartiality mean in your office? Because, you know, I do see a lot of us losing our properties out here in favor of others. So let me know what that means to you, sister. And like I said, great seeing you.
Thank you. Impartiality means that I judge every case and every person based on the facts. I have people that come in and they may have made a mistake and missed a payment, and then we make sure we give them the options and explain to them what they need to do to bring their self current. I have people that have not paid a mortgage in 8 years and have lived for free. 8 years, never paid a mortgage, never paid taxes, never paid insurance. The mortgage company has paid all of that for 8 years. So you handle each case individually, making sure that every protection that they're entitled to by the statute that governs mortgage foreclosures is followed. Make sure that they get it. Make sure that they have that extra last chance to save themselves if they can do it. And if they can't do it, then maybe we can work out, they can work something out with the bank to get a graceful exit. But everyone that comes into the mortgage foreclosure courtroom is not a scafflaw. They didn't just decide they didn't want to pay their mortgage. And so they're not treated like that. Everybody in my courtroom is treated with respect. And in fact, probably my number one complaint from the lawyers who are working for the bank is that I take too much time explaining to the pro se litigants. But that's it. That's what my job is, to make sure I service them, to make sure I service the bank. I treat them fairly. I decide every case on the facts. And it's better for me to take time and do it right than to rush to judgment and do it wrong. At least that's in my opinion.
That makes sense to me. Well, look, as we begin to close out, take a moment, look in the camera, and remind the people just how well qualified you are and why they should retain you. I know it's about 60 plus other people, but right now you're the only one that's sitting on the seat, so that's who we focus on now. So let the people know why they should retain you.
I want to thank you for this opportunity.
Absolutely.
I have been on the bench since 2011. Before that, I was an alderman of the city of Chicago, 6th Ward, for 13 years. Before that, I practiced law, primarily doing criminal defense, and in small law firms for many years, trying cases in Illinois, Michigan, Minnesota, Indiana. I was a trial lawyer. I have been in mortgage foreclosure for maybe 8 years now. Not only do I sit on the bench, but now I am a member of the Judicial College for the Supreme Court. I worked my way up from just being a faculty member at one of the educational programs that we give to being on the committee that put those educational programs together, to being on the committee that oversees the educational training for the judges, the probation officers, the trial court administrators, So I'm on the Judicial College now. So I put a lot of time in professionally for the improvement of the legal system in Illinois. And one of the things I did this last time for our last conference is make sure we increased, just phenomenally increased, the number of Black and other minorities that participated as faculty, because mm-hmm. I know that in some parts of Illinois they only see litigants, only see Black people when they're coming in as with a crime, and I wanted them to see Black people as their peers. So we put more Black judges on all of these panels.
Nice.
I am past president of the Illinois Judicial Council, which is the Association of Judges. I'm past president of the Cook County Bar Association. I'm on the board of directors of the National Bar Association, the Association of Black Judges throughout the country, as an affiliate of the NBA. And I'm sat on that board for the last 5 years, and this year I'm co-chairing the scholarship committee for the Judicial Council of the National Bar Association. So I am
grateful
that people found me to be qualified. I get on the bench every day, and I pray that I've got, you know, sound mind, and that I am going to remember that my job is to do justice.
Yes, ma'am.
And that it's not about the job, it's about the purpose, and my purpose is providing representation to the communities that I come from.
You said it well, ma'am. Have they given you all punch numbers yet?
Yes, I am. I got a cheat sheet here. We just got it, and it's not appearing on anything yet. And I wanted to make sure I didn't give the wrong one. 275.
I don't want you to give anybody else's.
Please, we want you to look up the judges. We've got some really, really great judges that are on the retention list. Really great. And we would be at a tremendous loss if we did not retain them. Not only just the ones that are from our community, but if we get them wiped out, we're starting from scratch.
Yes, ma'am.
But from the other communities, we've got some great white judges, we got some great Latino judges, and we just need people to take a minute and find out.
Self-preservation is the key, so we're going to start off with you. But thank you so much for joining us, and we're definitely going to have you back prior to the election, Judge Lyle. So thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you very much for having me, and I'm so glad to see you in this chair.
Hey, well, you know, we were trained to do so
you were,
I appreciate
it. You were, and I think that everyone would say that it was well worth it, and you have exceeded their expectations.
All praise is due to Allah. Thank you so much, ma'am. Look, we're going to take a break, and we're going to come back and have the co-founders of this great organization on to talk more about the film showing that I mentioned earlier. So don't touch that dial. You can still call in. The number is 773-434-6625. We'll be back.
Reach their fullest potential. Our biggest obstacle? A few years ago, it was to get state government to pay our invoices. Under Bruce Rauner, we were owed hundreds of thousands of dollars. Everybody's job was at risk. But J.B. Pritzker has helped turn things around. Now the state pays bills on time. J.B. understands that in order for me to do my job, he has to do his job. I used to spend my time worrying about how we were going to keep our doors open. And now I spend my time thinking about our kids.
came to me like this, that this is the Son of Man that the Bible say that prophesy that will come.
You are watching the Muneer Muhammad Show, a production of Crow. Please take time to join us at Crow, the Coalition for the Remembrance of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. Crow is the National Archive of the Nation of Islam and houses one of the largest collections of historical audio, video, and print documentation on the total black experience. Crow is located at 2435 West 71st Street, the corner of 71st and Crow Lane. We are open 7 days a week, 9 to 5. Our number, 773-925-1600. We look forward to seeing you at Crow.
And we are back to the Muneer Muhammad Show. I'm Brother Mandeen Muhammad. Want to thank Judge Lau for joining us in that first segment. Joining me for the remainder of the show are the co-founders of this great organization. It's definitely a big switch. I've traveled with them most of my life, but I think this is absolutely the first time that I had a chance to actually talk to them on camera. I wish we had more time. We're going to have to definitely do this again. But joining me is Brother Khalif Muhammad and Brother Shaheed Muslim. As-salamu alaykum.
Wa alaykum salam,
brother.
Let me say, it's an honor. You know, I never thought that I would be doing this, but this is what we've been trained to do, and yes, and we have to push forward with it. But we don't have a lot of time for a lot of pleasantries, or as you would say, what's the word you would say?
I would say thank you for letting us debut.
Yeah. But what we're going to do, we got this film showing that's coming up this Saturday, October the 8th. And it's our first film showing, I believe, since the hit with that pandemic.
Yeah.
And so we are definitely looking forward to it. We're going out. We saw that beautiful commercial that our sister Diana did. So, but here we are. So what are your thoughts about, you know, our coming out again?
I'm just looking forward to it, you know. That was one of your brainstorms, you know, to start doing that, and this will be a first of charging just free 99.
Now we did free before, because Brother Muneer was ready to just to get rid of it totally, and so I told him that I'd take it from here.
Right.
But it was easier said than done, because you couldn't even get us away. You know,
right.
we had food for the people and everything, but it was just. Mm. It was difficult to bring the people to knowledge, though. But,
yeah.
But what are your thoughts, Brother Shaheed?
Well, I think it'd be good for the people, because, believe it or not, brother, you still have a lot of young people out there that don't know anything about the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. So this would be their chance to come here to Crow, who is the archives of the Nation of Islam, and they can learn some things about the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. Some of the things maybe that they have probably heard that are false, but they can get the truth of the teachings of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad and those who follow the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, because, like I say, it's quite a few people out there that don't know anything about the Honorable Elijah Muhammad or either about Crow anyway, you know, because it's just what they've been doing.
You're seasoned, you've been around, you've seen a lot. What do you think that we could do more to attract, you know, not just people in general, but more young people?
Yeah, one of the things I think we could do is stick with the plan that we've been using for the last 36 years, is talk about it and invite them. You know, I think a lot of people don't realize the real impact of the Nation of Islam under the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, because we didn't have social media and any other kinds of aids like that. Mm-hmm. But that word of mouth eventually gets you. An interesting thing I heard on one of your commercials is that it takes people seven times after something that's been advertised for them to respond to it. And I believe that because I know this work. I definitely was not looking for this information when I found it.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. What do you
think? I think also, brother, it would help people because a lot of people think that once you come in and visit a place where Muslims are given some type of event that you are obligated to join, but we're not obligating nobody to join. We just want to let you know about the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. Then some of the things that we say or some of the things that you hear, you might enjoy that a lot because you might have something in your life that's hurting you or keeping you down or where you can't be successful. Mm-hmm. But once you hear the teachings of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, that might spur you, you know, to be successful in your life.
Yeah. So consistency is definitely the key. Right. And one thing about it, I know you all, along with Brother Manette, always stress that we gonna keep the lights on, the phone on, and keep the door open. And I often reflect on Brother Sharif. Sharif looked at the show for a whole year
right
before
right.
he came out. So mm-hmm. just imagine if we decided to close up one day or what right. the hell, whatever the reason, we could have lost a great brother like, or you know.
Like him.
Like him, absolutely. So, but the interview, Viola Drive is
right.
is the film showing, the film that we're going to show right. this coming Saturday. What can the people expect, and how do you all come up with that? Because we got an arsenal of films to show, but how do you...
Thought about it because of the time, mm-hmm. you know, what the Honorable Elijah Muhammad reveals in the interview is a lot like what you really see it on the news today. Some of the signs that we just fail to recognize with all of the clarity, but hopefully if you'll join us and come out and sit and watch it and listen to it, it'll do something for your life. I know it'll improve it.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. We do have a call before we let you
okay,
call. Are you on the air with the co-founders of Crow?
Assalamu alaikum, brothers.
Walaikum salam, sir.
Brothers, I wanted you all to talk about the importance of coming to the organization and immersing yourself in the environment and seeing the film and studying in this age where everybody could just look at things for the convenience of their homes. Talk about the importance of the fellowship of coming in person and being around each other while you soak up this information.
That's an excellent point.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Excellent. The atmosphere is very conducive, you know, because of the brotherhood, not only that's being talked about, but that you see. It's actually a feeling, something that is really intangible. You can't just describe it, but just being next to your brother or sister sometimes. That's why you go to the picture show
right?
rather than the TV. You could have watched it on TV, but... Come on out and join us.
Yeah. What say you?
I think one of the things, brother, it would be most of the people think that when you come in and visit a Muslim's gathering, that they're going to try to force you to join. We're not going to try to force anybody to be a follower or a Muslim in the teachings of Islam as taught by the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. But we just want to show you what the Honorable Elijah Muhammad did for our community, how he helped people. I know he helped me. He saved my life with the religion of Islam as taught by the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. And some of the things that you hear in this tape that we're going to show, it might not be everything that you like, but some of these things are going to save your life or help you be able to do good for yourself.
Yeah, I think it'd just be great just for the people to come out, especially those that have never been to Crow before, get a chance to actually, because I know unless they've been living under a rock, they had to hear something right. about Crow and the Honorable Elijah Muhammad himself. And to be able to come out and come get it straight from the horse's mouth and actually
right.
see him speak on tape. And a lot of people, you got a lot of young Muslims that have never heard the Honorable Elijah Muhammad speak.
Or seen him.
So that'll be, that's great within itself. And just like you said, Of course, you can look at films and things or whatnot in the comfort of your own home, but there's nothing like being out amongst people again and just meeting somebody new.
Yeah. Islam is congregational. Though we're not trying, as Shahid said, to get you to join anything, but I think the environment, the atmosphere, you know, sometimes when we watch things together, you know, I'm going to pick a piece out and you're going to pick a piece out, but something makes sense to everybody.
And, you know, you just said something that I've been trying to tell people, because we, like I said, you come in contact with a lot of people who say, well, you know, I still study, but I don't come out. Right. But Islam is based off the congregation, like you said, being around like-minded people. Right. And I think Sherazad Ali, she said it best, your environment is stronger than your nature. So it's nothing like being around like-minded people. But we're quickly closing out. So, again, let the people know when, where, what time, and put that emphasis on how much it is.
It's free, $99, and it's this Saturday, October 8th. It's in recognition of the birth anniversary of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. And we also going to do a tribute for my brother, the great late Munir Muhammad.
Yes, sir.
The inspiration for the coalition for the remembrance of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad.
Praise be to Allah. Unfortunately, we have ran out of time. I really thank you all for joining me for this abbreviated segment of the show. We're definitely going to have you back sooner than later. Thank you so much for listening. As I greet you in peace, Assalamu alaikum.